back in 1979, 78, with disco, which is the grandfather, per se, of house, you know, was big. And so all the disco DJs across the country knew each other. You know, and I was an understudy. A lot of people don't know this. I was understudy under the great Ken Collier. And back in the day, there was a big three. They were all from New York, but split up. Frankie, Ken Collier, and Larry Levine. And them three split up. Ken Collier went to Detroit, Frankie Knuckles went to Chicago, and Larry Levine stayed in New York. Now that's another story in itself, the Paradise Garage. Whole another story, a whole another history story in itself. Talking about house, I hate not talking about house without talking about disco.
Got to.
Now some purists of house get upset because I'll say house is a derivative of disco. Now if there's no way that you can't tie the two in. Because think about it, Louie Holloway, South Soul Orchestra. You know, you can't deviate. You know, that is a derivative of that. You know, all the music back in the day, Susie Q. I mean, I can name a whole bunch of records that were disco records that led to house music. You know, but house, you know, but I'll say that, but house was his own thing though. Now I will say, it may be a derivative of disco, but house is a whole genre all by itself.
Chicago has long been known as the home of house music. While today is common knowledge that house took its form from what was often the bridge of R&B songs and the grooves of disco music, it was the city and people of Chicago that built house. This is Indianapolis. Indianapolis is 184 miles from Chicago, but when it comes to house music, it may as well be a million miles from Mecca.
So how and when did you first get introduced to house music?
Right after house the telephone rang. Hold on, man. Put that in there.
House go round. Oh, man. I got introduced to house music 1985, 86.
I'm going to say 1982, sophomore year high school. St. Joseph College Prep High School, Westchester, Illinois.
The question of how I discover house, it's not a really a quick answer to that question because I didn't necessarily discover house per se, but I guess I kind of have to give a background on where I'm from in order to answer the question completely.
My cousin Gilbert was going to school up at Purdue University. And he had came back and said, man, I gotta introduce you to this music.
First time, I didn't know it was house music, but it was like, I think I was in middle school and it was Crystal Waters. And it was my favorite.
I was first introduced to house, I would say, initially, my dad was a DJ, and I started messing around with his stuff when I saw the movie Beat Street, and I was a break dancer. And at that time, I got into dance music and early hip hop and funk and soul and all that because of being a dancer.
I was intrigued by the DJs. At that time, I was a dancer. And we house dance, you know what I'm saying? We get it in. We jack it.
I'm from Gary, Indiana. Grew up in Gary, Indiana. But we're right next door to Chicago. A lot closer to Chicago than people may think. Actually, on a good day, I used to be able to get from my mom's driveway to downtown Chicago on Rush Street in 15 minutes.
So I'm Slater Hogan. I'm from Indianapolis. And I started going to raves and underground parties here in Indianapolis kind of in the early 90s, and the music was a mix of kind of house, like Chicago house, and then there was a heavy Detroit techno sound, and I like both of them, but just kind of gravitated to the disco and jazz influences of the house music stuff at that point.
Well, you know, to start things off, to help everybody else, you know, when you Wikipedia house music, they give you a little bit of the background of the house and the whole, you know, basement slash warehouse scenarios that they used to have. I forget what they used to call them. They didn't call them warehouse back in 81 and 82.
It was a garage, right?
It was a garage thing. It was another thing. I forget, you know, the name escaped me. I'd have to look it on Wikipedia. But all of that molded into, you know, 85, 86. That's when house hit.
I just want to talk about how house music in my life has always been a great experience of love, acceptance, spirituality, energy, and just positive, safe vibrations.
But my ear caught hold to a DJ named Mr. J and Dr. Gunn. And we were at the Rec in Maywood, Illinois, on Fifth Avenue in St. Charles.
I remember the day like it was yesterday. I was walking down the street, and this is before people really had like boom cars, you know? And I just heard this like 4-4 just kicking. And like this track was going out of it, and it was just amazing. Like it was so dope that I had to like stop the car. I like stopped him in the street and was like, what are you listening to? And it was these kids that had moved down to Bloomington, Indiana to go to school, and they were from Chicago. And they were listening to French Kiss by Lewis. And I was like, man, I was like, I'll do anything to get a copy of this. And they were, we ended up talking, they were like, you know, it was tape deck, so I had like the double cassette. And they made me a copy of that. It wasn't even out on vinyl yet. It was just a tape that was floating around Chicago.
So he finally comes down. Has his tape, man, that he recorded off WBMX, man. And we listening to this music, and I'm like, yeah, all right. Yeah. I ain't impressed, you know. I mean, it's cool, but, you know, coming from hip-hop, you like, whatever.
House go round. My early DJ career where I was into hip hop, but hip hop was going in a direction that I couldn't identify with as much, because that was when gangster rap was getting really big, and I was like, I'm a white kid from Bloomington, Indiana, you know, I couldn't like really get down with that as much. And house music was dancing again; it was taking me back to my roots.
You got the godfathers of house, of course, Frankie Knuckles, you know, I hate the fact that I've never actually. Oh, I take that back. What am I talking about? I did meet Frankie.
I was about to say, come on. I know you met Frankie.
I've actually been ashamed of myself. I went to the warehouse in 87. I had a battle of the DJs. And I went to the next day we went to the warehouse in Chicago. And believe it or not, it was empty. But of course, I was there at midnight. So, you know, there wasn't nobody there yet. And, you know, we got to the door. And, you know, we thought we were somebody, you know, Indianapolis DJ radio. And, they didn't have us on the list or anything. So Frankie came to the door. And I said, Frankie, Ken Collier invited me here. Doors open wide open.
In 99, I found the rave scene. I lost my dad, so I found a connection in the rave scene and found house music. And knew that it was house music then.
I really didn't discover house, because for me, house always was there. I grew up in the time in middle school where we didn't hear a lot of rap or rap mixes on the radio. When I was in middle school, every weekend, Fridays and Saturdays, there was three stations, WBMX, WGCI, and Hot 96. So I grew up hearing house mixes on the radio every weekend.
But as he would come back down each weekend, he would have these tapes, and we'd listen to this music, we'd listen to this music band, and it started to grow on me, because just like any other music, you know, if you find one track, and then that leads you onto your journey to what it is that you like.
And if you know about Frankie Knuckles, if you know about the start of house music in Chicago, it's truly something that's unique that has started as a seed and just spread through, maybe back in the day when we didn't have CDs, but we had tapes. You know, Frankie put out a mixtape, one person copied it and passed it on to the next person, just like, what is the copy that it passed on? And that influence just really expanded.
But the house music that we know of, man. We're talking about Indianapolis. 1986 is when J.M. Silk came to the radio station at TLC, and I interviewed him on the air. You know, young cats, you know, got it going on, but they were stars already because the circuit's already selling.
We would listen to the Hot Mix 5, man. Julian Jumping Perez was my man. I liked him. No disrespect to none of the Hot Mix 5, but I kind of took a hold to, you know, his mixing style.
After just attending those parties for a while, I got the urge to kind of learn how to DJ and started DJing at a club in Indianapolis that would let me use their gear and take it home every night. It was called The Patio. It was in Broderpool.
Mr. J and Dr. Gunn provided the sound and all the music. And then they allowed some younger brothers to come and start learning how to play the music instead of dancing to the music.
And I loved like just the feeling and the togetherness of it all. And I was like, so I started like really like seeking out the mixtapes from BMX and also from Detroit and things like that. And that was kind of how I initially got into house and started DJing house music and trying to expose my friends to it.
Lisa, Cold Jam, stuff like that. That was still borderline house music, but it was more like dance music. But there was a group off of Fever Records, man, the Cover Girls, man, and the song was Show Me. Oh man, they would play this record, man, over a house break, man. I was like, man, now this is what I'm talking about. Expose, man, I can go, man, 85, 86, 87. Oh man, that was some good hot ass house, man, you know.
So when I think about how I grew up with house music, it kind of makes me smile and brings back fond memories. There's certain songs that stand out that definitely influenced me. Jason's Revenge was huge for me, as well as 13 Problems by Johnny Dangerous. Those two songs right there, kind of, I can't even explain it, but when I heard those songs and starting to hear those songs in mixes on the radio, it just kind of did something to me.
I fell in love with house music. I wanted to know more about it. And there's so many different colors of house music. That if you want soulful house, if you want that house music that makes you feel like you're at church, it makes you feel like you're, you know, working out, if it makes you feel like you're in love or you're about to go on a date or you're somehow trying to impress a girl, you can actually find songs throughout house music that express that vibrancy.
Of course, you know, that's the beauty of house. The beauty of house is like hip hop, but better because disco birthed house and house birthed everything after that. I mean, if it wasn't for house music, you know, there was rap songs. And there's one particular rap song that has a house track that I play, and that's MC Light. Light as a Rock. That was a hot crossover house track. Now, if rappers aren't, you know, hip hoppers, you don't stop, are making house tracks, remixing their tracks to have house tracks, then you know it. House was hot, man. And you can't take nothing from house. You may not like it, but get a few drinks in you and you'll start tapping your feet, and before you know it, you'll have your ass on the dance floor, man. You can't front on house. I don't care what it is that you like, man. Piss on you.
Yes, sir.
But 1986, Walker Theater, and it was, I went on the radio with it, and I mean, I pushed it like a concert. I pushed it like, man, you, and it was people calling and saying, what is it? They didn't even know what I was talking about. They thought I was talking about, you know, kind of a basement old school R&B party. And I said, no, you just need to come for yourself.
One of the memorable DJs that tried to smart a house scene here was Geno Shelton. Geno was, and I have to say, the first. Number 111, hoo-ha, first promoter to promote house music here in Indianapolis.
So when I first moved to Indianapolis, it was 1994. The house music scene here, I just assumed because Indianapolis being so close to Gary and Chicago, they would have a house scene. And I used to throw house sets in the area here in Indianapolis called Broad Ripple, a club called The Eat, to be exact.
It was, Indianapolis is, I think it's situated in an interesting thing geographically because we are close to Chicago, but we are almost as close to Detroit. And a lot of the DJs were into more of the Detroit techno. Like I was, in the beginning, there was only a couple of people that I knew that were that were DJing like Chicago House.
But surprisingly enough, the crowd that came was some implants from Detroit here in Indianapolis. So we had a core group that would come out. It wasn't that many, maybe 15, 20 people.
My experience with it is when I would go and play some house music, the club owners would not like that. They wanted more poppy stuff. They wanted more, you know, top 40, stuff like that. It's awesome that now it's everywhere. But I think that we didn't blow up here because the club owners weren't allowing the DJs to really play it that much and, you know, stay there.
You know, I think it's just probably twofold. I think one, Indianapolis has never had a radio station dedicated to house music, and in Chicago you had that, and so the music was kind of able to get out there to a very broad base of people. And
the stigma I got on house music when I first arrived in Indianapolis, you know, it was a different time than it is today. So a lot of people kind of view house music as gay music. That's just the reality. That was the perception of a lot of people I ran into in Indianapolis in the 90s.
And this is one thing that I don't think a lot of people, especially in Indiana, understand is the rich history of how house music can really just connect you to other different cities, other different mindsets, or other different ways of just existing as a human being and a black man or a black female or even a person of color who may be Latinx, you know, Puerto Rican, whatever it might be. We're all there within the genesis of house music.
From my point of view, it had transcended that. It turned into something that was for everybody, that was just good music. Because we did hear it consistently on the radio growing up. Like I said, from sixth, seventh grade up until high school, you know, I remember just hearing house on the radio. So you have to realize that I was kind of fighting against that perception. Because I didn't grow up with that perception. Like I said, when I came up, house music was played on the radio. So we knew that was a part of the culture that it came from, but from my point of view, it had transcended that.
I think with house music, being what it was and how it started, that community was always under threat. Even in Chicago, it was under threat. And so a lot of people aren't willing to risk that vibe, you know, to put that out there and truly advertise it. Indiana has always kind of been a little bit back. We're catching up now, but if you can kind of even think about Miami market, New York market, Chicago market, even with mainstream music, they're gonna get it 3 months before we get it. And then they're gonna say, hey, this is the vibe that really was tested in this market. Now go ahead and go this way.
It was definitely a culture shock musically, me moving from Gary, Indiana, coming to Indianapolis in the 90s because they looked at it as solely being gay music.
Thing is, I think people are afraid to open their mind and be free. See, where we come from, you know, up north, Chicago, that music was like a music of freedom. You know, you can be yourself, you do your thing. Some people say, well, it's for the gays or it's for these or for that. No. That house music is for everybody.
And they were like, cool with that, but I think the stigma came from it was considered like gay. And the straight kids were like, oh, I don't know how I feel about listening to that because people might think if I like it, I'm gay, you know?
I know that house music has always been embraced, and I've always been embraced when I've gone to Talbot Street, which is a gay club. You know, that is really where I was really able to play house music to really just while I'm playing it, I'm not getting those the energy, the feedback from that crowd back to me in the DJ booth has been just pure love. Now, if I take that into a mainstream club, I play house music all the time in every single set, but I work it in, you know? I'm playing a hook from a popular song on the radio, but the underlying beat is a house music song, and then I just kind of had to mix it up.
I remember I was there. Wasn't supposed to be there, but I was there. From that point on, you know, hit and miss. There were people that, you know, did some house or so-called house, and it never really, you know, transpired like house should have transpired. Being so close to Chicago, you know, we're only 3 hours away, 2.5 if you're doing 80. This global music that we're so close to never hit the 317 like I believe it should have.
I think here in Indianapolis, the people that like the true Chicago sound have all gotten older and they don't frequent the clubs, and the kids that are coming out and frequenting the clubs and spending the money, they've been introduced through house music, through festivals, these EDM festivals, right? And so I think it's like this techie kind of bass sound of like the EDM market that has kind of gotten them involved in it, and they haven't been exposed to the real house music sound yet.
So they came, some of them stayed, some of them didn't. But we had over 300 people there, and we banged nothing but house. Nothing but house.
Wow.
You know, it was pure house.
Is on the other side. They have embraced house music and the dancing long before we have. I mean, they embraced it. I mean, if you honestly want to hear some kind of house music or go to a dance club, we're going to be the minority instead of the majority, and in any shape, form, or fashion, as far as being patrons and being the producers, promoters, and sure enough, the damn DJ. Because, you know, I can only name probably two or three that look like me on the house scene around here. And the rest of them, you know, white boys, man. Nothing taken from them. I mean, because, you know, they my DJ brothers. But, you know, they're the ones that have, sadly enough to say, put house music in a position here, but not in a position of its urban simplicity.
So we are in a red state. We are in a conservative state. And I do feel like that we've got so much working against us, and only through, you know, just perseverance of just like showing people, bringing your kids, you know, bringing your aunt, bringing your uncle, just say, hey, you know, this is gonna be different, but I want you to see the vibe, feel the love that we're trying to put out there.
You know, a lot of people are a little bit touchy about this, but I'm gonna say it anyway, you know, because it don't matter to me. You cannot talk about house. If there wasn't a gay population,
you can forget it.
You wouldn't have it.
This genre would not exist.
Yeah.
Straight up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whether you're gay or not.
I'm not saying you have to be gay. You know what I'm saying? But they were the pioneers. Frankie. Larry,
yeah,
you know, Ken Collier, all gay, you know, but they were the pioneers of this music. And the great thing about those three is that they didn't care what you were so much.
They just cared about the music.
They cared about the music, yeah. You know. Ken Collier brought me in, and I used to DJ at Studio 54 in Detroit back in 1979, in Detroit, Studio 54 in Detroit, as his, like, protege. And everybody swore I was gay. Because I was with Ken all the time. I carried his records, I did whatever I had to do to be down. You know, with Ken Collier. But I was willing to learn and willing to take that chance because I love the music, you know? I love the music.
Tastemaker of the DJ has to just say, hey, you don't know this song, but it's amazing. And to be honest, when the crowd doesn't know a song, they look toward the DJ.
It's amazing to me because you hear stories of other DJs, the Hardys, being in the club, playing the record 6 times in one night. I couldn't imagine being in the club and the DJ trying to pull that off in this day and age. But that's really what a DJ does, mm-hmm. is hip you to the music.
Yeah, and this is the whole thing too, is you gotta, if I play the song, but I kind of have an unsure energy, and you look at me, and I'm like with my eyebrows looking like, do you like this? And you're gonna be like, oh, you know, this song is not that great. But if I'm gonna like, if I'm getting it, and this, that energy, it spreads out. You are that light in front of the whole club, and everybody's like, man, he's in the zone. And so it's a feedback loop. And it also is sometimes can be, if you're not a mature DJ, it can be dangerous. Because if you put it out there and they don't accept it, and you keep trying to push it on top of them, reach your crowd. You know what I mean? You might say, hey, I thought it was gonna be a banger, but y'all didn't do it. Have that, you know, song ready to push through. But you have to just keep pushing down. You tried it once, maybe you didn't mix it on point, maybe you didn't drop it the right way, but keep going at it. And that's where you said, if they dropped it 6 times, so what? You know, that's the way it happens, is when your brain hears something, your brain is just trying to figure it out. It's trying to remember the drops, it's trying to remember the hooks, it's trying to remember the arrangements, it's trying to remember the key of that song. And a good song is something that you really want them to just walk away from, like, hey, you really worked. You really put up some work up there, you know? And that's just kind of where I think you gotta be. You know, sometimes I may not get invited back to a club. The owner will tell me, this is what I want, this is what I expect you to play. I'll smile, but once I get up there, it's my show. You know what I mean? I'm here to do my job. I'm gonna push out these songs. It might be an Arabic song. It might be a German song. It might be a song from South Africa. It might be something from Nigeria. But if it is the right song at the right time, you know, and this is the vibe, if I see that I've got a crowd out there, and I say, hey, you know what? They've been doing some salsa moves. They've been doing some moves in a show that somebody knows how to dance. If I give them truly something within that key, if I put like some soulful house on there, and then I just kind of mix it in, I'll play maybe something that they know that might be like Shakira, or it might be something that bridges that gap, but then when I drop it into where I want to be, you know, I've got to, like I said, I've got to have that confidence to put it out there.
I really just wanted something of my own. So I wanted to actually make some, like, create a vibe instead of playing other people's vibes.
And all of that is basically a branch of house music from where we began with it to where it is now. So it still lives right now.
And we went into a local record store, Luna Music, and there was a magazine in there called Music Magazine, and it was a big UK electronic music dance magazine. We opened it up, and Pete Tong had a few of our songs charted in his top 20, and we couldn't believe it. And you know, it was all because Mark had gone over there and given him the CD and kind of introduced him to the Indianapolis underground sound at that point.
Fast forward to 2020, and I'm still kind of blown away that everything is considered a subcategory of what we consider house.
Went on, we put out over 100 12 inches and remixes, and toured the world for 8 years, and now we own our own club here in town.
Okay. And house music, unfortunately, did not have really somebody who was flying that banner as strong as they could. And I kind of try to do it as I can and try to put it out there with no reservation, just say, hey, this is what I'm doing.
Through Indie House Sets, we've actually had house sets where we feature many different DJs. And we've had people looking for a particular style of house come out. Well, the DJ that's performing may not have been playing the style of house that they wanted to hear. The lineup may have included DJs that played that style of house, but because they didn't hear that style of house in the first 20 or 30 minutes of them being at the event, they left. So they missed the house that they were looking for.
I just think that the more that we as DJs or as entertainers, try to expose it to people. It's really us as a position of power to be tastemakers.
It may be more EDM. Well, if you grew up in those areas, what you got with the beginning of house, with the beginning of techno, may be totally different sonically than what you're hearing today. So that was part of the purpose of me originally throwing house sets at the Eden and Broad River. So I never made the connection that the music they was playing at Rave's and some of the other stuff I was hearing was a derivative of house music, because I never felt that same groove, that same soul.
They're able to add what they want to it now. Yeah. Like you say, EDM, electronic drum music, whatever it is. They have taken it and blown it out of proportion in a good way, in a good way. And the thing is, now we're starting to say, okay, oh man, that started in Chicago, or that started in New York or Detroit.
So when I think of what I refer to as the soul of house, or the groove of house, the closest thing I hear today that reminds me of that is the fascination. I don't even want to say fascination. It's just the groove of Afro house. It puts me in the mind state that I was when I first really got into house, is that soulfulness or that groove, so to speak.
I think that, you know, whoever started creating this Afro house, I think they probably listened to music that we were listening to in the late 80s, early 90s, track music, and they've added their own twist to it, man. But it comes with such an original Afro-style beat and the continuous play of it. And, I mean, if you got any soul, any feeling inside of you, that's what make your heart pump, man. And you know, you can go on and on and on. This ain't your 2 minute, 3 minute style of play.
So to me, it sort of seems like a new trend in the music per se. Everybody's kind of leaning towards and jumping on the Afro house train. But from where I stand, it really just goes back directly to Chicago, traditional pure house music because of the groove.
I love that the Afro house is coming in and being a dominant part of the house music scene. It does take me back, like I say, to the late 80s, early 90s, you know, but again, not to knock any other style of house music, you know, but it's great to have that be a part, and it does bring some old thoughts, some old feelings, and some old people like myself.
And every time that we have an event, there's always somebody that I meet that's from Chicago, from Detroit. And when they tell me that they've been here for years, and it's like, oh man, we didn't know you guys did stuff like this, you know? And I you know, I would always say, what you do? You go back to the crib so you can hear, you know, house music? And they always say yes.
It's gonna take collaboration of all three, and those that head up all three, those that are being followed, those that have the network, those that can reach the people that are following EDM, commercial, original, grassroots. They have to sit down at a table, and like anybody else, sit down at a table, come up with a plan. You gotta come up with a plan to bring all of us together.
What we've enjoyed though is owning our own club is we can say, you know what? We can do a commercial hip hop night tonight and make a grip, like make a lot of money. But being the club owner, we can be like, you know what? No, that's not necessarily where our heart's at. I'd rather make enough to get by and keep the doors open and pay our bills and support house music and promote house music and expose kids that maybe didn't know about, especially to like the Chicago side of stuff, you know, having that venue to be able to expose kids to it, that's been probably the greatest joy of owning a club. Like being able to walk in and have a place look and sound the way that we want.
Invite three friends. If you're already a part of what the movement is, invite three more people. And I mean, before you know it, it'll blow through the roof. And whether who's playing, you're involved of a family of people that love the same grassroots sound, man. And that's house music. Well, that's my message to everybody. Keep listening, keep being involved, and keep bringing people out and getting involved. And we'll have what you call the real love music back again. All right? That's what I'm talking about.
The joke, man, I say a lot of times people don't start with house music, but they all end up there. Like, I think as your musical tastes mature, you realize the subtleties and the intricacies of house music. And I think, you know, I know so many kids that were like dubstep guys, and now they love house music. And they're like, I never thought it was like that cool when I first heard it, but you know.
If it was able to be played back in the day, if it was something to move the dance floor, if it had that beat, that energy, that really just brought it up to a point of a higher mind, a state of mind, that's the kind of house music that I like to play. That's the kind of house music that I feel like the best DJs will play. And you're gonna go through kind of like just a journey.
But it's a great movement. It's a lot of people that love and have a feel for house, disco, and just a good culture. It's still underground here.
I've sat down with young men who are just kind of fed up with the rap, with the gangster stuff, and they're like, you know, their soul, they say, is not as vibrant when they're listening to it. But when they hear me play, it's like you flipped it in a different way. And I said, this is energy. All music is gonna be energy. And then, you know, Chicago itself was under threat even when Frankie Knuckles was playing, even when all these clubs were playing, you know, we still have to understand why.
You know, even with my organization, Indie Househeads, you know, we're a grassroots organization. We've been in the mix for 5 years. And slowly but surely, we are starting to make headway.
Been around a long time, and I've been a part of this a long time. From being a dancer to a DJ to a promoter, the whole nine yards, man. We have to keep this thing going and growing. That's what we do. And whether you Chicago, Gary, Indy, Detroit, New York, if you're here in Indianapolis, make sure you check in with us at Indy Househeads, man. Go to our page on Facebook, become a member. It costs you absolutely zero to become a member. That way you can follow and know where we at, and you can come out and be a part of this love movement of house music. And don't forget, if you're a hater, get a hate up and keep your weight up. And if you're inside somewhere, don't forget out the do-do is the po-po. So drive slow, slow. Indy Househeads, Butta Man got to go.
For me, I'll just keep playing it, making it. It makes me happy. It is a reason that I am not on a different path that would be really bad. So just continue with that.
So would you say that the DJ or house music to some extent saved your life?
Absolutely. It did save my life.
Okay. Go introduce me to house music. They would come visit every summer. One summer they brought house music on a cassette tape. I was immediately hooked. So that was my intro to house.
Drawing the house music. Well, I tell you what, I think it was back in the 90s, my sorority sister asked me to come clubbing with her in Chicago. We were in South Bend at the time. And I had heard of, you know, house music, you know, a little bit in Michigan. But it wasn't until the 90s when I started actually going to the clubs that I was really broke in. So back in the early days, you figure we were going to the warehouse, we were going to Buddha Lounge, you know, so Thursday nights we were kicking it. And so those are the days where I became a true househead.
I'm a newbie. 3 years ago, my fella brought this music over, and I had the hardest time trying to cook up a meal. He turned this music on and I said, oh yes. And ever since, I'm late for work every day trying to take a shower, listening to house music.
All right.
Love it.
All
right.
You snapping. Why you gonna wait till the end to snap like this? DJ Freddie Fresh.